Abounds with Gaieties, written and read by P.O. Dixon.
Chapter 1. Longbourn Village, Hertfordshire, England, December 1811. Miss Elizabeth Bennet hated seeing her elder sister in such low spirits. Jane's cheeks looked somewhat sunken. She lacked a healthy glow, and her bright, angelic eyes seemed to have dimmed, all for the cause of her lover, Mr. Charles Bingley. The gentleman had promised to return in a few days, but it was now a week later. Jane, who never complained about anything, said, "Were it simply a matter of his being late by a day or two, I would have no cause for concern. I should imagine the business which dictated his return to town has yet to be resolved. However, Miss Bingley's letter plainly stated her brother is to remain in town indefinitely, and I am beginning to believe her." Elizabeth sighed and put aside her book. "Dearest Jane, may I remind you again not to take Miss Bingley's letter to heart?" Although she too was beginning to have doubts. Not that she doubted for a second that Mr. Bingley was in love with Jane. However, Elizabeth would not dismiss the power of the gentleman's sisters and his closest friend, Mr. Darcy, over him. She could think of no other explanation for the remaining inhabitants of Netherfield to take their leave on Mr. Bingley's heels other than to persuade him to remain in town. Miss Bingley's letter to Jane had arrived within a day of Mr. Bingley's departure, thus casting an air of despair over Longbourn. The news came shortly after Elizabeth had been the means of ruining her eager mother's scheme to secure the Bennet family's place at Longbourn in the event of her husband's demise. The morning after the Netherfield ball, Mrs. Bennet was confident she would rid herself of one of her five unmarried daughters, determined that her eldest was soon to be married to their new neighbor. The matchmaking mamma had pointed Mr. William Collins, the heir apparent to the Longbourn estate owing to an entailment, toward her second eldest daughter. But to the lady's surprise, Elizabeth had declared she would not have him, and owing to the manner of her refusal, which Mrs. Bennet had the misfortune of hearing through a closed door as she happened to place her ear against it, Mr. Collins abdicated his plan to choose a bride from among the Bennet daughters. Elizabeth recalled the part of her speech to Mr. Collins that had spared her from his design for future marital felicity involving her. "I should have paid more attention to the wisdom of Miss Lucas. She was quite right about your unwavering determination to marry for only the deepest and truest kind of love," Mr. Collins conceded. "There is a sensible young lady if I ever met one. She would never be foolish enough to jeopardize the security of her family and herself for such a fanciful notion," he added, sounding rather wise himself to Elizabeth's ears. With one arm folded over the other, Elizabeth had said, "Then perhaps you ought to be standing before her, rather than wasting your time here with me." The shock on her mother's face when she nearly fell inside the room was such that Elizabeth would not soon forget. Nor was her mother's ensuing disapprobation something Elizabeth would quickly overcome. That her mother would think Elizabeth would commit to an alliance that would bring her nothing but misery was one thing, but that was nowhere near the worst part of Mrs. Bennet's lamentations. In front of Mr. Collins, Elizabeth's mother accused her of thinking too highly of herself, simply because the proud Mr. Darcy had singled her out for a dance at the Netherfield ball. She still felt the sting of her mother's words clawing at her sensibilities. Anyone who knew Elizabeth well knew how much she disliked the proud Mr. Darcy. It was not as though she had a choice in the matter. To have declined Mr. Darcy's request for a dance would have meant sitting out the rest of the ball. Elizabeth was not inclined to forego her share of the evening's gaieties. For her mother to suggest that Elizabeth forgot what she was about because of her dance with Mr. Darcy was vexing, for it meant her mother did not really know her at all. Considering the way Mrs. Bennet lamented Mr. Bingley's continued absence, she did not know her eldest daughter either. Surely, if her mother exercised more temperance, Jane would not be so ill at ease. Jane sighed. "I fear following your advice not to take Miss Bingley's letter to heart is easier said than done. I know how much you dislike her, but I have never seen her in an unfavorable light." Elizabeth could not argue with her sister on the latter score, for Jane was too good not to see the best in everyone. Jane always gives everyone the benefit of the doubt. Elizabeth did not falter. She only hoped Jane would never come to understand the less than agreeable side of humanity. For if she did, she would lose some of the light that made her so special. Far be it from me to be the one who poisons your mind against Miss Bingley. But I do not believe she acted in her brother's best interest. On the contrary, I believe she was thinking only of herself. Consider her assertion that her brother is amorous of Miss Georgiana Darcy, for instance, Elizabeth said, referring to the part of Miss Bingley's letter that Jane had said hurt her the most. Jane had purposely pointed out the part that read, I really do not think Georgiana Darcy has her equal for beauty, elegance, and accomplishments, and the affection she inspires in Louisa and myself is heightened into something still more interesting from the hope we dare entertain of her being hereafter our sister. I do not know whether I ever mentioned to you my feelings on the subject, but I will not leave the country without confiding them, and I trust you will not esteem them unreasonable. My brother admires her greatly already. He will have frequent opportunities now of seeing her on the most intimate footing. Her relations all wish the connections as much as his own. And a sister's partiality is not misleading me, I think, when I call Charles most capable of engaging any woman's heart. With all these circumstances to favor an attachment, and nothing to prevent it, am I wrong, my dearest Jane, in indulging the hope of an event that will secure the happiness of so many? And to think, Jane had thought Miss Bingley had meant well. She could not have conceived that the woman's words were an open rebuke, intended to make her feel small. Instead, Jane had interpreted Miss Bingley's words as well intended and meant to spare her feelings. Did Mr. Bingley ever once show any sign of suffering or tender regard for the young lady? I dare say he never once mentioned her name. And what of the young lady's own brother? It is hard to suppose he would sit idly by while the man destined for his sister was courting someone else. A man like Mr. Darcy would not have disregarded such conduct. In hindsight, can one really say that Mr. Bingley was courting me? I never saw a man more violently in love, said Elizabeth. Indeed, no one who has ever seen you together can doubt his affection. Miss Bingley, I am sure, cannot. She is not such a simpleton. She would have ordered her wedding clothes if she had seen half as much love in Mr. Darcy for herself. One might suppose Mr. Bingley made a beginning, but who is to say his return to town did not remind him of what he is really about? Even you would argue I might have done more to encourage him. If not Miss Darcy, surely there are many other young ladies with whom he might spend his time. Young ladies who are far more receptive and encouraging than I was whenever we were together. I am sure your chance will come soon enough. Let us wait and see what happens before you give up all hope of Mr. Bingley's return. Jane sighed in resignation. Very well. I will try. For now. Chapter 2. Darcy House, London, England. Having been forewarned by way of a message from Mr. Hurst, who undoubtedly acted under the influence of Miss Caroline Bingley, it did not surprise Fitzwilliam Darcy when a servant showed his friend, Charles Bingley, into his study. Bingley, whose countenance was twisted into an expression of complete vexation, was on a mission. Having dispensed with all the usual civilities, the younger man came straight to the point of his visit. Darcy, old fellow, he said, I need to talk with you. I have heard all I wish to hear from my sisters regarding this matter. I want to hear from you why you returned to London on the heels of my leave-taking when you and the others were meant to remain in Hertfordshire. I promised Miss Bennet that I would return in 3 or 4 days. I fully expected you would still be there. Now I am trying to piece together what went wrong. Did I misunderstand your intentions? No, you did not misunderstand my intentions, but I could not in good conscience let you continue your course without intervention. Hence my return to town with the hope you would remain here. My course? What do you mean? You were behaving much too recklessly. I studied you and the young lady during the ball at Netherfield. I was persuaded her feelings are not as engaged as yours. You would be wise to cool your ardor and allow for some time and distance between the two of you to gain a better perspective. Bingley appeared crestfallen as Darcy made his claim. The younger man looked aghast, his eyes wide open, his mouth ajar. At length he said, "No, I am certain Miss Bennet feels the same way about me that I feel about her. Therefore, there is no need to slow down my courtship. I love her and intend to make an offer of marriage in due course of time." Darcy frowned from his mouth to his brow. His lips set in a disapproving line. "That would be a mistake, Bingley. You should not rush into such a momentous decision without giving it proper thought and consideration first. I cannot think of anything more important than marrying the woman I love, and if you truly care for me, you will support my decision. Bingley, think of what you are doing. You risk throwing away all of your advantages in life by aligning yourself with someone like Miss Jane Bennet. She is from a family of no consequence. She has no fortune, despite her angelic charms. You can do so much better." "I love her." Darcy shook his head. "You are young and impulsive, and you do not know what you are about. I care about you too much to stand by and watch you make a mistake you will regret for the rest of your life. There is nothing you can say that will change my mind. If Miss Bennet will have me, I very well plan on marrying her, and I would appreciate your support, not your judgment. What you are asking goes against everything I firmly believe. As your friend, I would not see you make such a grave mistake. I appreciate your concern, but I am a grown man and can make my own decisions." Darcy was about to say something else when Bingley held up his hand. "I will not mince words, Darcy. I fear you are the one who is most interested in protecting yourself from your attraction to Miss Elizabeth Bennet." Darcy could not deny his fascination with Elizabeth grew by the day while he remained in Hertfordshire. There was an air about her that drove him to distraction. The sparkle of her eyes, the twinkle, and the joy he saw there spoke more clearly to him than any woman he had ever known. Her eyes spoke of happiness and playfulness, of fierceness and passion. They drew him in. But he also knew enough to keep whatever feelings she had incited in him at bay. His own feelings aside, there were other matters to consider. "Indeed, you are mistaken, my friend," Darcy said after a moment. "I am thinking of you and your future. For me not to return as promised must certainly subject Miss Bennet to everyone's derision for disappointed hopes. I simply must return to finish what I started. Should my efforts prove fruitless, then at least I will know I tried." "I am not saying your efforts would prove fruitless. No doubt the young woman would marry you in a heartbeat, if for nothing else, then for the sake of her family." Bingley, whose voice was thick with emotion, said, "You speak as though you believe Miss Bennet is mercenary, when you must know it could not be further from the truth. Regardless of what you think of her mother, Miss Bennet should be neither faulted nor characterized in such a manner. Is her own sister's behavior not a testament to that? My sisters told me all about the uproar caused when Miss Elizabeth refused Mr. Collins's hand in marriage." This was news to Darcy. The Bingley sisters had not breathed a word of it to him. This picture in his mind of Elizabeth in the arms of another man robbed him of his composure. The one woman in the world he dreamed of holding in his arms night after night, only in vain. Darcy felt a flash of rage. His hand gripped the arm of his chair. "When did Collins do that?" "According to my sisters, it happened the day of the Netherfield ball. Do not tell me you did not know." Darcy always knew how much the youngest Bingley sister loved to tease him about his fascination with Elizabeth's fine eyes when they were all together in Hertfordshire. Had his singling her out for a dance at the Netherfield ball further fueled Miss Bingley's jealousy? What did she mean by keeping this intelligence from me, when making sport of the Bennet family's lot in life is one of her favorite pastimes? "It is true. I do not have the highest opinion of her mother, her three younger sisters, or even her father, owing to his questionable behavior on more than one occasion. Still, I always excused Miss Bennet and Miss Elizabeth from such censure, as they always seemed far more sensible than the rest of their family." Dare I say you seemed more than a little bothered when I told you about Mr. Collins's proposal to Miss Elizabeth? Why would I be concerned one way or the other? If she indeed refused the man's offer, it would have been imprudent on her part. I understand he is the heir apparent to her family's estate. So one sister is to be faulted for marrying for the sake of her family, and the other is to be derided for not marrying for the motive of duty? Is that what you are saying? Darcy's finding himself on the unenviable side of a logical discussion with his friend was indeed unfamiliar territory. I am not saying I find fault in either of them. In advising you not to rush into anything, I am thinking only of you and what is in your best interest. If you want what is best for me, then you will cease your objections to my scheme and return with me to Hertfordshire. Granted, I have stayed away longer than I had intended. However, I am sure Miss Bennet will understand once I explain my reason. Besides, remaining at Netherfield until the start of the London season is no less than what we had planned from the start, is it not? Caught in a dilemma, Darcy was forced to question his own motives for leaving Netherfield. He had to admit Miss Elizabeth Bennet had bewitched him like no other woman. If his friend was shrewd enough to detect the young woman's effect on him, would not others? Perhaps even Miss Elizabeth herself? What could he do? The thought of her affected him more than he cared to admit. If he did not face his unsettling feelings for her soon, he might never resolve them. Instead, he might spend the rest of his life in a state of confusion, avoidance, and possibly denial. This was a moment of truth he could not ignore. Darcy pressed his lips together and took a breath, holding it for a moment before releasing it. If it matters to you that much, then I will accompany you to Hertfordshire. I promise you will not regret it. And what of your family? Will they also be returning with us?
I might convince them, I suppose. Is that something you desire?
Darcy raised an eyebrow. What do you think?
Chapter 3. Longbourn Village. 2 days later. Catherine, otherwise called Kitty, was looking out the window when she espied two figures heading up the lane toward the manor house. But unfortunately, she could not make them out. Her younger sister, Lydia, soon joined her at the window. A stout, well-grown girl of 15, with a fine complexion and good-humored countenance, Lydia quickly dismissed the imminent guests. Neither wore a red coat, so they meant nothing to her. Elizabeth hoped against hope that at least one of the guests would be Mr. Bingley. As for who the other might be, she dared not speculate. At length, the door was thrown open, and their visitors entered. It was Mr. Bingley and Mr. Darcy. Elizabeth's pleasure was tempered a bit upon seeing the latter. Why on earth had he come? Had he not taken his leave on the heels of Bingley's departure with the intention of keeping his friend from Jane, as Elizabeth had thought? The confusion in her mind was nothing compared to the joy on her sister's face, which was enough to make Elizabeth forget her earlier suppositions. The guests were received in the usual way, and Mr. Bingley took his place in the empty seat beside Jane, while Mr. Darcy chose a seat conducive to his looking out the window. "There is the gentleman I recognize so well," Elizabeth considered. "He means to be taciturn and silent, making me wonder why he returned to Hertfordshire." Mrs. Bennet said, "It is so kind of you to call on us, Mr. Bingley. We were beginning to believe you might have changed your mind about returning to Hertfordshire, especially after your sister wrote a letter to my Jane to that effect. But you are here now, and that is all that matters, is it not?" Mr. Bingley shifted in his seat a little. "I am afraid my sister, in writing to Miss Bennet to convey the news of her returning to town, mistakenly supposed her plans aligned with mine. Allow me to apologize for any confusion her letter may have caused," he said, while looking at Jane. "Then I take it your sister did not return with you to Netherfield Park?" "My sisters remain in London. Many of Caroline's dearest friends are in town, and I could not persuade her to part with them. So Mr. Darcy and I are the sole members of our party." How long do you plan to remain in these parts?
My plans for remaining in Hertfordshire are not definite, but I can honestly say there is nowhere else I wish to be.
Bingley's response was all that Mrs. Bennet hoped it would be, and Elizabeth could not help but be pleased, too. She knew she was not mistaken about Bingley's affection for her dearest sister.
There is all the more reason for me to hope you will take a family dinner here with us at Longbourn. I shall take care to have 2 full courses, mind you. Indeed, you must come as often as you like. You and your friend, Mr. Darcy, although I doubt anything we might offer is up to his exacting standards. Still, either of you would do far worse should you decide to dine at Lucas Lodge.
Speaking of which, there has been quite a development since we last saw you, Mr. Bingley. Miss Lucas is engaged to be married.
Elizabeth braced for whatever nonsense was about to spew from her mother's mouth next. Mrs. Bennet was a woman of scattered thoughts, with a shifting disposition that vacillated from dismay to vexation at the slightest upset, and she possessed an overactive tongue. She was on a constant quest to find husbands for her daughters. When she was not doing that, she delighted in visiting and gossiping with her friends and neighbors.
Mr. Bingley said, "Yes, I have heard. I must congratulate the happy couple when I see them."
"So you know about the young lady's engagement to the heir of Longbourn? Bad news must surely travel fast to have reached all the way to London so quickly." She shook her head and sighed. "When given a choice between the ungrateful and the undeserving, the gentleman chose the latter, it would seem. But what do I know about such things? For no one ever listens to me or considers my feelings.
Surely you must also know Mr. Collins came to Longbourn with the express purpose of choosing a bride from among the Bennet daughters."
Here Jane interrupted her mother.
"I am sure our guests have no interest in discussing Mr. Collins's marital travails. All further lamentations Mrs. Bennet might have wished to espouse were halted when Mr. Collins entered the room."
Elizabeth could not help but throw a worried glance in Mr. Darcy's direction. She remembered how her ridiculous cousin had all but assaulted him the night of the Netherfield ball.
"Mr. Darcy," Mr. Collins exclaimed, as though there was no one else in the room but the distinguished nephew of his noble patroness, Lady Catherine de Bourgh. "I did not know you had returned from town and called on us here at Longbourn. What an honor it is to receive you. No doubt Lady Catherine will be pleased by your being here in her stead to wish me joy on my good fortune. I shall be certain to thank her, as I indeed thank you, for such munificence on your family's part."
Unlike the night Mr. Collins attacked him at the ball, when Mr. Darcy was eyeing him with unrestrained wonder and replied to his undoubtedly absurd speech with an air of distant civility until the point where he could suffer the man no more, and at the end of it he only made him a slight bow and moved away, there was no such opportunity in the confines of the Bennet's parlor.
"I have been spending most of my time at Lucas Lodge of late, else I would have been here when you arrived. But mind you, I have not lost sight of my primary responsibility to your aunt, the Right Honorable Lady Catherine de Bourgh. I shall soon return to Kent, in case there is some intelligence you wish me to convey. Furthermore, I shall be sure to apprise your noble relation of your being here, in case she has some reciprocal intelligence she wishes me to pass along to you upon my imminent return in time for the occasion of my nuptials. That is, assuming you will still be here in Hertfordshire upon my return, which I sincerely hope you will. For what an honor it would be to have you attend the wedding breakfast at Lucas Lodge, if not the wedding ceremony itself. I assure you that you and your friend will be most welcome."
Before she could stop herself, Elizabeth said, "Mr. Darcy, may I prevail on you to accompany me to my father's study? He and I have been embroiled in a debate about Shakespeare's body of work. Knowing you to be an excellent reader, I can think of no one whose opinion can better help resolve our stalemate." Given that talk of writers or books could not possibly stir her mother, Elizabeth congratulated herself when Mr. Darcy accepted her offer, and the two of them quietly escaped the room.
Chapter 4. There was no sign of Mr. Bennet upon their arrival. "I had supposed my father was here," Elizabeth said, almost apologetically. "He will undoubtedly be here shortly, as this is his favorite sanctuary. Shall we await his return here, or would you rather return to the parlor with the others?"
"I do not mind waiting here," Indeed, it is my preference, so long as you stay too. I suppose it would be inconsiderate were I to abandon you. However, for propriety's sake, I'm going to leave the door open, Mr. Darcy. She did not want to create fodder for her mother's matchmaking hopes, especially after her accusation about Elizabeth's lofty opinion of herself after Mr. Darcy singled her out for a dance at the Netherfield Ball. Mr. Darcy walked about the room, and Elizabeth was not sure if he was nervous or passing judgment. She could not quite understand the man. She apologized for it not being up to Pemberley standards. Mr. Darcy made an observation about one of the books lying on her father's desk, prompting Elizabeth to boast of her father's love of books and reading. "Yes, I know," Darcy said. "No doubt that explains your own love of reading." Elizabeth had smiled and nodded. "It was quite charitable of you to rescue me from my aunt's vicar," said Mr. Darcy, changing the subject. "It was the least I could do, though I must confess my motive in doing so was rather selfish." Mr. Darcy raised his eyebrows. "How so?" "I feared your friend Mr. Bingley, out of compassion for your sensibilities, would insist the two of you take your leave of Longbourn, thus cutting short his time with my sister. There would have been little chance of his doing that. Not after the lengths he went to in order to return. He fancies himself in love with your eldest sister. He entertains the notion that her feelings toward him are of equal intensity."
"And you do not, sir?"
"I do not. Not based on what I have detected between the two of them. Your sister is amiable enough toward him. No doubt she is not totally indifferent, but it does not differ from how she regards any other gentleman of her acquaintance, I fear."
"My sister does not show her true feelings to anyone. It is simply her way."
Mr. Darcy shrugged. "If you say so."
"What would you have her do instead?" Elizabeth asked, her temper rising. "Simper and fawn all over him? Would you have her always speaking, looking, and thinking for his approbation alone, overwhelming him with officious attention? Would that satisfy you?"
Before the gentleman could fashion a response in his defense, Elizabeth said, "Well, perhaps what Miss Bingley said is true. Your relations and you desire an alliance between your sister, Miss Darcy, and Mr. Bingley as much as his own."
"No, no," Mr. Darcy said. "I would rather you not put words in my mouth, or ascribe Miss Bingley's fanciful musings to me. As for the latter, so long as my sister marries an honorable man, and enters a union with equal parts love and respect on both sides, I shall have no cause to repine."
"So, you are saying you do not cling to the idea that said gentleman is Mr. Bingley?"
"I have not given it any thought."
"And as for the other charges, I do not think overwhelming a gentleman with officious attention is a symptom of love. But bestowing an abundance of smiles, as your sister is wont to do, is not evidence enough of affection either."
"If you are so persuaded of my sister's indifference toward your friend, it is a wonder you returned to Hertfordshire. You might easily have remained in town with your like-minded cohort, Miss Caroline Bingley."
"Despite what you may think of me, Miss Elizabeth, I am not so officious and close-minded as not to admit I may have been mistaken. Among other things, Bingley made a persuasive argument about his feelings for your sister and her feelings for him, so much so that I owed it to both of us to revisit my initial assessment. And if you still stand by your original assessment, let us say after a week or two, then what? Will you do everything in your power to separate them again?"
"I have no intention of thwarting my friend. I am merely here to support him in whatever decision he makes."
"I suppose that is some consolation," Elizabeth said. "However, you said, among other things. What other factors came into play in your decision to return to Hertfordshire?"
"I hope my being here will provide the answers to several questions circling my mind. Those of a more personal nature."
"How interesting, sir."
"How so?"
"You have always struck me as someone who knows his own mind. And yet you willingly confess to being plagued with uncertainty. Now that I can rest assured your primary employment during your stay has nothing to do with thwarting my sister's hopes, I ardently hope you find all the answers you seek during your stay. Again, Miss Elizabeth, you are very generous."
And just as I rescued you from Mr. Collins as proof of my generosity, you must be sure to let me know if there is anything I can do to help you along in your quest. I imagine we shall spend prodigious time in each other's company now that my sister and your friend are reunited. We need not cling to past animosities. One day, we might even be friends. Her spirits rising to playfulness, Elizabeth said, I dare say stranger things have been known to happen. Past animosities, Miss Elizabeth? I dare say those are not words I would cite as playing a part in our acquaintance. Sir, your saying that tells me you indeed have not been paying attention. Why, from the very beginning, from the first moment, I may almost say, of my acquaintance with you, your manners impressing me with the fullest belief of your arrogance, your conceit, and your selfish disdain for the feelings of others. And the fact that you told your friend I was merely tolerable and not handsome enough to tempt you were such as to form the groundwork of disapprobation. Tell me anything but that my sentiments were one-sided. One-sided indeed, Miss Elizabeth. I did not know you overheard what I said to Bingley, which is no excuse. I should never have uttered those words at all. I can only apologize and hope you will find it in your heart to forgive me. I never meant to insult you. I did not mean a word of it. The truth is, I have long considered you one of the handsomest women of my acquaintance. And for those instances in which you thought me arrogant and disdainful, I pray you will forgive me that too. Elizabeth sensed her color rising at his compliments on her beauty. His sincere apology deeply touched her. With such a declaration as this, she said, how can I not but forgive you, Mr. Darcy? But it will take time. Drawing nearer, he asked, how much time do you suppose? Elizabeth felt unable to respond to his question. Or was it a challenge? It was not so much the words, but the way he looked at her. Elizabeth could feel the gentle drumming of her beating heart pulsing through her body. His presence was overwhelming. Mr. Darcy's voice had a softness that was not there before, and it was not something she was used to hearing. Miss Elizabeth, he said, even closer now. As he moved closer still, she smelled his masculine scent, a mix of musk and sandalwood that intoxicated her senses. Yes, she managed to say, a trifle breathlessly. I ask again, how much more time do you suppose? Elizabeth's eyes fluttered to the floor. You mean for my forgiveness? I mean for whatever you will bestow upon me. Elizabeth was speechless. A man had never spoken to her in such a manner, and she was unsure how to react. After a long moment, she finally looked up at him and felt a sudden flutter in her chest. Something about the intensity of his gaze made her feel both vulnerable and exhilarated all at once. She was drawn to him, unable to resist the magnetic pull between them. A light tap on the partially open door proved to be Elizabeth's saving grace, as it allowed her to remember where she was and what she was about. Then, just as her father walked in, Elizabeth quickly stepped away from Mr. Darcy. Lizzie, I thought I heard voices. Oh, good morning, Mr. Darcy. I see you have returned to grace our presence again, and so soon upon the heels of your leave-taking, Mr. Bennet said, nodding and greeting to the other man. Mr. Darcy returned the greeting in kind. Elizabeth was relieved when her father interrupted them. Still, she could not help but feel a twinge of disappointment. She was unsure of what would have happened if he had not come in when he did. She noticed her father's eyes flickered briefly toward her before he spoke again. I hope I am not interrupting anything. No, not at all, Elizabeth quickly replied. Mr. Darcy and I were just having a conversation, Elizabeth said, trying to sound nonchalant. I see that, her father said, his eyes twinkling with amusement. I will leave you two young people to continue your conversation. With the last look at Mr. Darcy, Elizabeth's father exited, leaving her and Mr. Darcy alone again, and the door opened wider than he had initially found it. Elizabeth could feel herself blushing as she looked at him, and she was grateful he seemed as embarrassed as she was. I am sorry about my father, Elizabeth said, her voice low. I am afraid he likes to tease all of us quite a bit.
Mr. Darcy nodded. I understand he is known for his sardonic wit. There was an awkward pause between them, and Elizabeth fidgeted with her attire. So, what were we talking about? Elizabeth asked, trying to break the tension. Oh, nothing of consequence, I am sure. I had just complimented you on your beauty, Mr. Darcy replied, his eyes pouring all over her. Indeed, completely inconsequential. And of course, I begged your forgiveness for having come across as rude, which you expressed your willingness to bestow, allowing for the passage of time. Yes, that is correct, Elizabeth said, biting her lip. And other things, Mr. Darcy continued, the light tone he had used the moment before having disappeared. Yes, other things, Elizabeth said, meeting his eyes. She felt herself melting beneath his gaze. She could not keep her eyes from darting over Mr. Darcy's face, taking in all the handsome features that made up his countenance. She wondered why she had been so unaffected by his beauty before. He was tall and lean, and his eyes were dark and brooding, and seemed to burn into her. She found herself wondering how it would feel to kiss his soft lips. Miss Elizabeth, Mr. Darcy said, bringing her attention back to the conversation. Yes, Mr. Darcy? You seem distracted. Dare I ask what you are thinking? Oh, no, said Elizabeth, shaking her head. You mustn't ask. Heaven forbid what he might think or do if he knew her answer. Mr. Darcy smiled and came closer to her. And why is that? Well, because I am not sure how you would take the answer, Elizabeth said, taking a step back from him. The truth was, she did not want to admit she had been thinking about kissing him. The mere idea of it made her feel faint. This man, easily one of her least favorite people, when she arose from her bed that morning, was making her think and feel in ways utterly foreign to her maidenly sensibilities. She realized if she did not come to her senses soon, she would be in grave danger from him. I am sure that whatever thoughts you are entertaining while gazing at me are perfectly innocent, Miss Elizabeth. Unless you are having second thoughts about casting any past animosities aside, at which point I will have to work even harder to earn your good opinion. Elizabeth colored, unable to answer. She felt a strange warmth spreading through her body, and she knew with certainty she was indeed in danger. What are you thinking about? Mr. Darcy asked, his voice low and soft. Elizabeth shook her head, not trusting herself to speak. She could feel the heat of a blush spreading across her face. Surely Mr. Darcy noticed it. Please tell me, he persisted. I will not take offense. I promise. Elizabeth took a deep breath and met his eyes. I was thinking about kissing you, she said, the words coming out in a rush. There was a moment of silence between them as they stared at each other. Elizabeth heard her heart pounding in her chest, and she was sure Mr. Darcy heard it as well. He moved closer to her and reached up to tuck a stray strand of hair behind her ear. What did you conclude? He asked, his voice little more than a whisper.
Chapter 5. Mr. Darcy, she finally said, I think it would be best if we return to the parlor. I am sure my father is expecting us by now. Of course, Miss Elizabeth, Mr. Darcy said. He offered her his arm, and Elizabeth took it after a slight hesitation. She knew this was not the end of their conversation, but merely a reprieve, one she would hang on to for as long as she possibly could. She could feel the heat of his body through the thin fabric of her sleeve, and she had to fight the urge to lean into him. She would have to be more careful in the future around this man. He was indeed a danger to her, not only to her reputation, but to her heart. Not 1 minute passed before they spotted her sister Jane, who was headed their way. Elizabeth immediately surrendered her companion's arm.
as though she did not want to be misunderstood by her sister. Not that she was afraid of what Jane might think, but she did not wish to supply fodder for anyone's imagination, not when her own mind was in such a state of confusion and uncertainty. Jane informed them that Mr. Bingley had prevailed on her for a walk, and she thought they might enjoy a bout of fresh air, hence her coming in search of them.
Papa informed me that the two of you were in his study, so how fortuitous to find you heading back to the parlor. I hope you are agreeable to joining us. Mr. Darcy cleared his throat. Who else is accompanying Bingley and you on the walk?
Kitty and Lydia left the parlor soon after the two of you, Jane said. I fear Mama was quite unsuccessful in persuading Mary to join us. Elizabeth said,
I believe Mr. Darcy wants to know if our cousin is joining your party.
Mr. Darcy smiled and said,
It appears your sister knows me very well.
Jane said, If avoiding our cousin is your design, Mr. Darcy,
you must congratulate my father for distracting him with a game of chess, else my cousin would have been quite eager to join us, I am sure.
As I am very much of a mind to enjoy the fresh air, I must thank Papa myself, Elizabeth said. What say you, sir? Mr. Darcy agreed, and the four young people soon set off for a walk. After what had happened in the study, Elizabeth was determined to stay as close as possible to her sister and her beau. But it seemed the latter had his own ideas. He only had eyes and attention for Jane, often speaking for her hearing alone, and in a manner that compelled Mr. Darcy and Elizabeth to outpace them. Once they were alone, it dawned on Elizabeth that her walking companion had barely uttered more than monosyllables while they were with Jane and Mr. Bingley. She wondered what had brought about this change. Was the gentleman still scrutinizing her sister's interactions with his friend and looking for signs of her affection? Elizabeth hoped he had moved beyond all that. Or perhaps he was not thinking of Jane and Bingley at all. Perhaps his mind was busily engaged with reflections on their time in the study. She hardly believed she had been so reckless, so bold. If I could recount my declaration, I surely would. Or would I? Of course I would, she silently considered. Elizabeth willed her eager imagination to cease once it veered to what the gentleman must be thinking. He was not being so quiet and aloof for nothing. Surely, if he had anything to say, he would do so. Thus resolved, the two silently walked along in no particular direction. This arrangement may have suited Mr. Darcy's temperament, but Elizabeth was not designed for such a scheme.
Better that intercourse is the order of the day, especially on a day as conducive to long walks and pleasant discourse as this.
Turning to her companion, who was walking a respectable distance from her, Elizabeth asked, What are your plans for the upcoming season, Mr. Darcy? Are they as indefinite as Mr. Bingley's? That I cannot say. I should hope to be here for as long as he needs me. Does that extend past Christmas, or do you plan to spend it at your home in Derbyshire?
With both my parents having passed away, and my sister in her own establishment in town, Pemberley does not always feel like home, especially during that time of year.
Elizabeth felt a swell of emotion for his losses. She could not imagine what it must be like to suffer the loss of a beloved parent, much less both of them. As they were standing much closer than before, she placed her gloved hand on his arm. Please accept my condolences, Mr. Darcy. He covered her hand with his and gave it a gentle squeeze. You are very kind. Elizabeth withdrew her hand and tucked her arms behind her back. Mr. Darcy said, I normally spend at least 6 months out of the year in Derbyshire. However, this year has proved the exception. What with my annual visit to Kent to visit my aunt and cousin, an impromptu trip to Ramsgate during the past summer, and my being here to help my friend navigate the ins and outs of estate management. Elizabeth said, I suspect once you choose to marry, it must surely be an inducement to spend more time at Pemberley. Miss Caroline Bingley is completely enthralled by its majesty,
and no doubt would jump at the chance of becoming its mistress. Why do I feel you are laughing at me, Miss Elizabeth? I thought we were to be friends. Indeed, we are to be friends, sir. Surely, I may be allowed certain liberties, may I not? As intimate friends, yes, I will allow you any number of liberties, so long as you understand it goes both ways. Elizabeth's cheeks grew hot. This conversation was as daring as the first. She searched her mind for a new topic to steer their discussion along a different, safer path. What are your plans for the upcoming season, Miss Elizabeth? Elizabeth silently exhaled. It was as though he had thrown her a lifeline. My aunt and uncle from town, Mr. and Mrs. Gardiner, always join us at Longbourn at Christmas with their young children. It is always an exciting time for our family, especially my mother, who delights in entertaining. My younger sisters love all the presents my aunt brings, and can never hear enough about the latest London fashions. And what about you? Do you also look forward to your relations spending Christmas at Longbourn? Very much so. My aunt, Mrs. Gardiner, is my favorite. Indeed, she is quite unlike anyone else in my family. Jane and I adore her, and have spent prodigious time with her in town. If you are still in Hertfordshire when she visits, I should like you to meet her. I am quite confident she will meet with your approval. Is this yet another liberty, Miss Elizabeth? Shall I begin keeping score? No, I know how you do not appreciate my cousin, is all. I did not want you thinking to expect more of the same regarding my London relations. In that case, I shall look forward to meeting her if I am still here when she comes. Continuing the discussion on Elizabeth's family, Mr. Darcy said, Your mother does not seem to look forward to the joyous occasion of your cousin's marriage to Miss Lucas. Indeed, she does not. My mamma believes my friend has stolen the right to be the next mistress of Longbourn, and she credits me for having paved the way for Charlotte to do so. I will not pretend I do not know Collins offered his hand to you in marriage, and you rejected him, but I am curious to know your reason. Elizabeth halted her steps and looked at him. Do you think I would accept the hand of a man I cannot honor and respect? You have met my cousin. You can have no doubt of what an alliance between the two of us would have portended. I suppose you must consider me imprudent for thinking only of myself by refusing such a man. You would not be alone. But in such matters as this, I am resolved to marry only for the deepest affection, and to a gentleman whom I admire and respect. Elizabeth now stood much closer to Mr. Darcy than when she had started her speech. Straining her neck to stare him in his eyes, she said, Now, hate me if you dare. Mr. Darcy closed the little space between them and placed his hand on her cheek. Elizabeth's eyes fell on Mr. Darcy's lips. His fell on hers. Elizabeth saw his lips come closer to hers and closed her eyes in anticipation. Her heart raced and her breath came in short gasps. She thought of nothing but the warmth of his soft, full lips against hers, and she leaned into him, yearning for contact. It is too soon, Darcy considered. Much too soon, he further thought, leaning lower and edging closer still. What had happened to his determination to return to Hertfordshire for the sole purpose of resolving the mysterious hold the bewitching young lady commanded over his sensibilities? How had she come to have so much dominion over his thoughts, his decorum, and his sensibilities in so short a time? In truth, she had him all along. Now Elizabeth was standing directly before him. Darcy had spent too many days thinking of such a moment as this, and too many nights dreaming about it. The moment when he would finally kiss her, feel her soft lips against his, hear her sweet, sensuous moans. The moment when all his self-control and restraint would be tested. A feather's distance now between them. The sweet smell of her perfume filled his senses. Friends, he whispered breathlessly. Do not hate friends. Later that evening, Jane and Elizabeth
were about to retire to their beds.
Jane was sitting in front of her mirror, brushing her hair, and Elizabeth sat at the window. The moonlight hit her face, flushed from the day's excitement. As Mrs. Bennet had prevailed upon Mr. Bingley and Mr. Darcy to dine at Longbourn, it had indeed been a long one. Jane said, "Your kindness toward Mr. Darcy today was unparalleled, given the way Mamma is wont to flood him with approbation, while practically ignoring his best friend. It was such a comfort to Mr. Bingley. I acknowledge it must not have been a pleasant task for you. You have never particularly enjoyed his company. I recall how much you always disliked him." I do not know that I would use dislike to describe my feelings for Mr. Darcy. "Well, at least not any more," said Elizabeth, still gazing out the window.
"Why ever not? What has changed?"
"I have reason to consider. I may have been premature in thinking Mr. Darcy was wholly opposed to your relationship with Mr. Bingley. His being here must surely count for something."
Jane stood across the room and took her place beside her sister.
"May I presume your improved opinion has its origins in my father's study?
Now that I think about it, you two were gone for quite a while. So, what were the two of you about?"
"I am surprised you noticed, given how absorbed you were with your Mr. Bingley."
"Your response is more of a deflection than an answer, but if you wish to keep it a secret, I shall not press. I fear I cannot tell you much more than that. It is not that it is a secret, but the fact that my time with Mr. Darcy has given me something to think of. Something I do not quite understand. But once I know myself, I will tell you."
"Very well. For my part, I am delighted Mr. Darcy returned with Mr. Bingley, and not his sisters with all their pretensions. I am sure my time spent with Mr. Bingley will be much more pleasurable knowing they are far away in town, attending to their own affairs."
Elizabeth clapped her hands.
"Bravo, Jane. Your astuteness where Mr. Bingley's sisters are concerned must surely be a good thing.
If you think that is something, prepare yourself to be scandalized.
Dearest Jane, whatever do you have in mind?"
"Only that I hereby resolve to show Mr. Bingley my true feelings. There is no sense in denying myself a second chance at happiness. Now that he has returned, I am no longer content to live cautiously. If my experience with our friend Charlotte has taught me anything, it is to pursue what I want and make no apologies for doing so."
Jane's declaration shocked Elizabeth, but she could not help being slightly intrigued. She knew her sister was always so proper and sensible, so this sudden change in Jane seemed almost unnatural. But as she thought about it more, Elizabeth realized Jane had a point. If she did not take risks and follow her heart sometimes, she would never truly be happy. "Do I not owe it to myself to be just as fearless, even if I have no clue where such fearlessness might lead?"
Chapter 6. Spending the next several days in the company of the two gentlemen, taking long walks with no particular destination in mind, and talking of books and travels and everything else that came to mind among sensible young people in the company of the opposite sex, might have been favorable for Jane's prospects, but it was wreaking havoc on Elizabeth's sensibilities. All she could do of late was think of kissing Mr. Darcy, so much so that her musings accompanied her to sleep at night. That morning, after suffering yet another dream of knowing what it was like to be kissed by the gentleman, she awoke with a start. "What am I thinking?" Pleased with his attitude toward his friend's courtship with Jane and the deference he continues to bestow towards me since his return, I completely dismissed all his ill use of Mr. Wickham, not to mention Mr. Wickham telling me Mr. Darcy is engaged to marry his cousin, Miss Anne de Bourgh. Am I so vain as to forget what I am about merely because Mr. Darcy flatters my ego so well? Elizabeth wondered what might have unfolded with the lieutenant had he attended the Netherfield ball as she had expected. She recalled in vivid detail having dressed with more than usual care for the occasion, prepared in the highest spirits for the conquest of all that remained unsubdued of his heart, trusting it was not more than might be won in the evening's course. The dashing gentleman possessed all the best parts of beauty, a fine countenance, a splendid figure, and a pleasing address.
how disappointed she was when she learned he was not in attendance. Her suspicion that Mr. Darcy had been the reason for Wickham's absence added to Elizabeth's disapprobation. His harsh critique of her favorite beau heightened it.
Mr. Wickham is blessed with such happy manners as to ensure his making friends. Whether he may be equally capable of retaining them is less certain. Not that Mr. Darcy's scathing comments had done anything to dampen Elizabeth's support of the young man.
Neither had Miss Caroline Bingley's subsequent warning against the lieutenant. If anything,
their distaste for Mr. Wickham only increased Elizabeth's esteem.
Except now, her truce and ensuing friendship with Mr. Darcy were causing her to question her loyalties. Was it possible to be attracted to two men who were so different from each other? She had persuaded herself that only one of the two was good, and the other was very bad. But now that she had grown closer to the latter, she realized he was not bad after all.
The turmoil in her mind was increasing with every minute.
The possibility she was wrong about Mr. Wickham was too much for her to consider. Elizabeth had only seen the two gentlemen in the same place at the same time once. It was on the street in Meryton. Soon after making the gentleman's acquaintance, she and her sisters were joined by Mr. Bingley and Mr. Darcy. Elizabeth recalled the countenance of both Mr. Darcy and Mr. Wickham as they looked at each other, and her astonishment at the effect of their meeting. Both changed color, one a shocking shade of pale, and the other a deep shade of crimson.
Mr. Wickham touched his hat,
a salutation which Mr. Darcy just deigned to return. What could be the meaning of it? Elizabeth recalled wondering at the time. Mr. Wickham's later accounting of his history with Mr. Darcy had resonated with her picture of the man. And considering herself an excellent studier of people's characters, Elizabeth had no reason to doubt him. Later that same day, Jane and her Mr. Bingley, Mr. Darcy, Elizabeth, and Mary walked to Meryton. The latter was there at Elizabeth's vehement assistance, for Mary owed Elizabeth a favor. This was her way of satisfying the debt. However, Elizabeth was not sure Mary was really holding up her end of the bargain, what with her trailing behind their party, with a book held close to her face. Jane and Mr. Bingley were content to entertain themselves, leaving Elizabeth and Mr. Darcy effectively on their own. The last thing Elizabeth wanted was to introduce a topic to Mr. Darcy that was sure to cause him consternation. But her desire to hear his side of the story of his history with Mr. Wickham was heavy on her mind. Biding her time, she spoke instead of the upcoming ball at one of the neighboring estates, one of several festive gatherings to be held over the course of time leading up to Christmas. The gentleman knew of the occasion and asked Elizabeth if she would reserve the first set for him. Elizabeth swallowed hard.
Do you not suppose it will cause people to talk?
That may be the case, but it is not like I have never singled you out for a dance before. My point exactly. Before she had too much time to think through the implications of Mr. Darcy's request, she caught a glimpse of her younger sisters on the other side of the street. They were standing with two gentlemen, Mr. Denny and Mr. Wickham. Whenever the younger girls were the recipients of the attentions of men donning regimentals, they always made a spectacle of themselves, and this was no exception. Jane and Bingley, no doubt disinterested in the scene, remained steady on their path, not bothering to cross the street and join the younger girls and their party. Likewise, Elizabeth felt obliged to do the same, although she waved to the others and received a tip of his hat from Mr. Wickham. A sidelong glance at Mr. Darcy confirmed what Elizabeth suspected. His expression was dour, with a hint of relief. Mary was the only one to join her sisters, no doubt intending to scold them for being so indecorous on a public street. Elizabeth seized the chance to ask Mr. Darcy about his history with Mr. Wickham. But she was determined not to follow a similar approach to the one she pursued during the Netherfield ball. "You take an eager interest in that gentleman's concerns," said Darcy, in a less than tranquil tone, and with a heightened color in response to Elizabeth's broaching of the subject. "Who that knows what his misfortunes have been can help feeling an interest in him?" "His misfortunes," repeated Darcy contemptuously. "Yes, his misfortunes have been great indeed."
"And of your infliction?"
cried Elizabeth with energy. Was it not you who reduced him to his present state of poverty, comparative poverty? Did you not withhold the advantages you knew to have been designed for him, depriving the best years of his life of that independence which was no less his due than his desert? Did you not do all this? And yet you dare treat the mention of his misfortune with contempt and ridicule. And this is your opinion of me. How dare you take umbrage at my wanting to hear your side of the story? I want to hold you in the highest regard, but you make it so difficult, hiding behind your mask of indifference as you are so wont to do, leaving everyone, including me, to fill in the missing blanks of your character. Darcy gave no answer, which only encouraged Elizabeth to continue. Will you not be more forthcoming with me, sir? Mr. Darcy took Elizabeth by her arm and led her to a nearby spot that afforded them some privacy. At length, he gave her an account of his history with the gentleman, indeed his childhood friend, which was diametrically opposed to all of Mr. Wickham's claims. Wickham's unfortunate fate was entirely of his own making. The worst part of Mr. Darcy's account had to do with his own sister, Miss Georgiana Darcy. Had it not been for Mr. Darcy arriving in Ramsgate when he did, a trip he had briefly mentioned to Elizabeth without going into detail, his sister's chances for a happy life would have been ruined. George Wickham had followed the young girl and persuaded her she was in love with him, a man nearly twice her age, for she was only 15. Wickham's true goal had been to get his hands on her fortune of £20,000. The hope of getting his supposed revenge on Mr. Darcy was no less an inducement. Elizabeth hardly knew how to think or feel, knowing she had been so wrong about Wickham's vile character. I am so sorry, sir. I did not confide all of this to you for sympathy, Miss Elizabeth. No, I know you did not. I should not have pressured you to relive what must have been a painful time in your life and your sister's. It is better that you know, what with your own sister's fascination with the likes of him. I shall certainly recommend they be more cautious. Not that it matters. Surely they are too inconsequential to tempt a man whose primary aim is mercenary. As for the two of us, how can I make amends for having judged you so unfairly? At this point, I can think of but one thing that will satisfy me. Oh, and what exactly is that?
You have yet to agree to reserve the first set at the upcoming ball for me.
Very well, Mr. Darcy. If that is your idea of making amends, then consider it done. Chapter 7. The Netherfield gentlemen were in the billiards room after a busy morning attending to estate matters. Both needed time to unwind. I dare say you are enjoying your reunion with your lady love as much as I am enjoying mine, said Bingley with a smile. Darcy moved away from his friend and quickly seized the cue. His interest in billiards lay more with play than talk. My lady love? I beg your pardon? Oh, did I say that? What I meant to say was Miss Elizabeth. Why would I not? She is a fascinating creature. You shall get no argument from me. No doubt you will ask Miss Elizabeth to dance at this evening's ball. You know how much I hate the idea of your standing around looking stupid all evening. I will be honored to dance with Miss Elizabeth. She has even promised me the first set. The first set, you say? If I must say so myself, that is saying something. No doubt you intend to dance the first set with Miss Bennet. Bingley nodded. If I had my way, I would dance every set with her. It would also say something were you to behave in such a manner. I would gladly tell the entire world how much I love Miss Bennet, but I am sure tonight is not the night. Before I can claim the right to do that, I have something more intimate in mind for my angel. I am sure you know what you are about. I do indeed. Getting back to the topic of your dancing this evening.
Any plans to grace the dance floor with others besides Miss Elizabeth?
You know how much I detest standing opposite those I do not know. Bingley nodded.
But what of the other Bennet daughters? No doubt they will be eager for dance partners, even among those of us who do not don red coats.
The two friends soon parted company, each heading to his own chambers to prepare for the evening. Bingley's mentioning of red coats caused Darcy to think of his nemesis, George Wickham. The scoundrel had avoided the Netherfield ball in November, but what was the possibility he would avoid this one too? Unlikely, Darcy thought. At least this time he would not be in the uncomfortable position of listening to Elizabeth praise Wickham.
convinced as she had been that he was an honorable man, whose misfortunes in life were brought on by Darcy himself. By now, he was sure she wanted nothing to do with Wickham, which eased his mind considerably. Moreover, the prospect of him harming Elizabeth's family was also removed, now that Wickham had set his sights on Miss Mary King, a young lady who had recently inherited £10,000. All of the Bennet sisters were excited by the prospect of attending the ball, especially Elizabeth. How different this affair would be from the last time she attended a ball, hounded by her ridiculous cousin, Mr. Collins, and distracted by her obsession with Mr. Wickham. She welcomed the prospect of no such unpleasantness that evening. As she primped and prepared, she could not help but feel excited at the prospect of dancing with the handsome and alluring Mr. Darcy. The mere thought sent flutters through her chest. As she walked toward the dance floor, Elizabeth could feel her heart slam against her chest when she had caught sight of Mr. Darcy standing at the edge of the crowd. He was watching her with a smoldering look in his dark eyes. Her heart raced as she made her way toward him. "Good evening, Mr. Darcy," she said with a coy smile, as he took her hand in his. "Miss Elizabeth," he replied, "it is good to see you. You look wonderful tonight." She felt flushed with desire as he led her into the first set. Their bodies moved in perfect harmony as they spun and dipped through the crowd. Together they laughed and chatted, each unable to keep their eyes off the other as they whirled across the dance floor. Dancing with Mr. Darcy was like nothing she had ever experienced. Unfortunately, it was over too soon, and Elizabeth reluctantly relinquished his hand. "It was a pleasure, Mr. Darcy," she said breathlessly. Later that same evening, Elizabeth silently fumed. Now that she knew what he was like, Wickham's power over the young women in attendance appalled her. So long as he was in the room, the other officers hardly stood a chance. Her two younger sisters were among the worst of the offenders, which barely made sense, for everyone knew the gentleman had set his cap at Miss King. Since they learned the sad news, the silly girls had talked about little else. Without discussing the details of Mr. Darcy's sister's travails, Elizabeth had shared her newly found distaste for the gentleman with her elder sister. She had no choice, for one did not go from being a favorite beau to a scoundrel in someone's eyes for nothing. Elizabeth speculated with Jane whether they ought to expose the gentleman. But in the end, they decided his past might not necessarily be held against him, not if it was his intention to mend his ways. Elizabeth's resolve was surely called into question once the gentleman transferred all his attention to Miss King. She was standing outside on the balcony, looking into the crowded room and observing the young ladies making simpletons of themselves, trying to tempt the officer from Miss King's side, when she heard someone approach her from behind. It was Mr. Darcy. He seemed to know without asking what was troubling her. "If I did not know better, I would think all the attention that gentleman is receiving bothers you." "Oh, I am bothered, but not for the reason you are insinuating. I just find it appalling that he has endeared himself to so many, making love to us all, when underneath the surface of his charms lies such vileness." Elizabeth folded one arm over the other. If only someone would expose him. The implication of her rantings hit her, causing her to gasp.
"Not that I am suggesting it should be you, sir."
"I would never ask you to put yourself in such an unenviable position of sharing your personal affairs and those of your family with others who are so wholly unconnected to you. I appreciate your concern for me, Miss Elizabeth. I am not insensitive to the danger Wickham poses to decent people. However, you must know my exposing him by revealing closely held family secrets is hardly a lasting solution. What will keep him from perpetuating his schemes in the place he lands next? The militia cannot always be encamped here." "You are correct, sir. Indeed, when I shared my frustration with Jane, she even warned that by exposing him, there is a risk of making him desperate." "You spoke to your sister about what I confided in you?" "Without getting into specifics, I did. But Mr. Darcy, I would never violate the trust you placed in me by speaking of it to anyone else. I know how close you are to your sister. Had you told her everything, I would not have considered it a violation of my trust. No doubt I gave you much to consider in enlightening you about Wickham's character. It could not have been easy for you to contemplate, just as it is not easy to stand idly by, concerned he might hurt someone connected to you. Mr. Darcy looked at Elizabeth with genuine affection.
I dislike seeing what this is doing to you.
Let me give this matter some thought.
Darcy extended his arm to Elizabeth. As for the immediate future, may I prevail on you for the next set?
2 sets in one evening, Mr. Darcy? What will people say?
We will not know until after we give them something to talk about. Elizabeth laughed and took Mr. Darcy's arm. He escorted her back inside, and they took their places opposite each other. Together, they danced across the floor, lost in each other's eyes. As the music filled the room, Elizabeth felt a quiver in her heart. Underneath the chandelier's sparkling lights, which cast a warm glow all around them, their eyes locked in an intimate gaze. Neither could look away. Elizabeth sensed he was studying her every movement. She felt nervous and excited all at once, wondering what he was thinking about her. She had never experienced such a feeling before, and she could not help but wonder if it was love. Her stomach fluttered and her chest felt tight. She could not concentrate on anything other than his presence. The thump of her heart filled her ears, drowning out the musicians, and she felt a sharp tingle of excitement in the pit of her stomach. And, excited as she was to suffer such an overwhelming tidal wave of emotion, she was terrified to think it very well might be love. Darcy was overwhelmed with feelings himself. He hardly believed how strongly he felt that night. He had never suffered anything akin to the sensation coursing through his veins as he danced with Elizabeth. He feared nothing would ever be the same after that evening, and he feared what his new feelings might mean for their relationship. Would Elizabeth feel the same way about him, or was he reading too much into a casual dance between friends? A sudden knowing came over him. He had fallen in love, irrevocably. He could not help the way he felt. In vain, I have struggled. It will not do. My feelings will not be repressed. He wanted to be closer to her, to hold her, and never let go. What have you done to me? Mr. Darcy considered as he gazed upon Elizabeth dancing with another man later that evening. He stood in the hallway outside the ballroom, watching her as she turned and swayed gracefully across the dance floor. His heart ached for her. He thought he had never seen anyone so beautiful. Mr. Bingley, who was standing beside him, smiled at his friend. She is quite lovely, is she not?
Indeed, yes.
And you concede you are quite taken with her. Mr. Darcy nodded. I cannot help it.
Chapter 8. The gardener's arrival ushered in a wave of gaieties and excitement at Longbourn. They were greeted with cheerful laughter and the hearty scent of fresh-cut greenery. The entire household seemed swept up in the season's excitement. My goodness, what a joyful scene, Mrs. Gardner said, looking around with a pleased smile. She handed her traveling cloak to a servant and sniffed the air. I can smell fresh boughs of holly and mistletoe, and I do not think I have ever seen so much greenery. You girls have been working hard, and everyone seems eager to celebrate.
Indeed, my sister Lydia and I have been bursting with impatience at the prospect of decorating the halls with boughs of holly and sprigs of mistletoe, cried Kitty. And who can possibly blame us, what with the militia encamped nearby, and the possibility of any of them coming to call? One cannot be too prepared, Lydia said.
Hence the overabundance of strategically placed mistletoe, said Elizabeth.
La! There is nowhere near enough by my calculation, Lydia exclaimed. But fortunately for us, there is still time before the dinner party. Once everyone had settled in the parlor, Mrs. Gardner was about to embark on the first part of the business of her arrival by distributing her presents when she noticed one of her nieces was missing.
Where is our dear Jane?
No doubt she is upstairs staring in the mirror and preparing for her Mr. Bingley's arrival, said Lydia.
Mrs. Bennet said,
indeed, our Jane is the luckiest woman in the world. I am sure Mr. Bingley will make her an offer of marriage soon, were it not for the persistent presence of his friend, Mr. Darcy, always being underfoot.
I am sure he would have done so by now. However, I must confess that Lizzie has been doing her best to distract the proud man and keep him out of Jane and Bingley's way, although I do not think she would be half so diligent in doing so, if not for the guilt she must surely suffer, having sent Mr. Collins straight into Charlotte Lucas's arms. Mama, Elizabeth cried out in protest at her mother's words, who among us can doubt what I say is true? Mrs. Bennet looked at her sister-in-law. I told you all about what happened, did I not? An amiable, intelligent, elegant woman, Mrs. Gardiner said, no doubt the gentleman's choice is ideal for his felicity. Mrs. Bennet scoffed. I am more concerned about my own family's felicity, which is why I am so delighted that Bingley has returned. I look forward to meeting all the recent additions to local society, especially Mr. Bingley. By now, Mr. Collins had gone back to where he came from. With every expectation, he would be sure to become the happiest of men upon his return to Hertfordshire. Thus, the Gardiners were spared the discomfort of making his acquaintance for the time being. Elizabeth was sure her aunt would love Mr. Bingley almost as much as the Bennets loved him, but she could not help but wonder how the Gardiners would feel about Mr. Darcy. The Gardiners were to stay a week at Longbourn, and to Mrs. Bennet's way of thinking, not a day was to pass without engagement, starting that very evening. The Phillipses, the Lucases, some of the officers, and of course Mr. Bingley and his friend Mr. Darcy, were among the guests at Longbourn that evening. Mrs. Gardiner, rendered suspicious by Elizabeth's warm commendation of Mr. Wickham and scathing rebuke of Mr. Darcy in past letters, afforded herself the wish to speak with both gentlemen. The shared connection between the parties made for an inexhaustible subject of discourse with both men during separate occasions, for Mrs. Gardiner had seen Pemberley and known the late Mr. Darcy by character perfectly well. She understood enough of the history between the two young men, again, according to her niece's earlier indictments, to know to converse with each independently of the other. Her assessments of the men were contrary to how her niece had described them. Indeed, one appeared to have all the goodness. The other, she feared, was severely lacking, and neither in the order she had expected. Scrutiny of her niece further confounded Mrs. Gardiner. Elizabeth rarely looked Mr. Wickham's way, and she scarcely kept her eyes off Mr. Darcy. She was determined to find out what had effected such a change in her niece's attitude. Lizzie, why did you not tell me before that Mr. Wickham had fallen out of favor with you?
Is it that obvious?
Indeed, not once this evening have I seen the two of you talking. If anything, you have gone out of your way to avoid him, whereas you and Mr. Darcy might easily be described as inseparable. Is it just as your mother described earlier, that you are doing your part to keep him out of Mr. Bingley's way? Or is there more to it than that? Dearest aunt, I must admit my motives are not as selfless as Mama likes to espouse. What exactly are your motives? Mr. Darcy and I are friends. I was a fool to believe all of Mr. Wickham's lies about him. He is a decent and honorable man, and there is nothing he would not do for those who are most important to him. Friends, you say? No doubt you know what you are about, but I recommend you take care. To an outside observer, there is far more intimacy between the two of you than mere friendship allows.
Chapter 9. It dismayed Darcy that George Wickham had the audacity to come to Longbourn that evening. He could not help but notice the man's eyes bore into him like molten lava about to erupt from a volcano at any moment. Wickham had something on his mind, and after what Darcy had done, he had an idea what it was. When he could, Darcy escaped the crowd and went outside under the guise of wanting fresh air. It did not surprise him when Wickham turned up on his heels. How dare you speak to King about my personal affairs, intending to thwart my courtship with his daughter? Courtship? The thought of you courting anyone is laughable. You and I knew what you were about, and now the young lady's father knows it too. What could my business with the kings possibly have to do with you? I would be remiss not to intercede on vulnerable people's behalf when it is in my power to do so. By what right did you interfere?
Because of you, Miss King will be sent far beyond my reach, when an alliance between us would have satisfied all my hopes for a better future. If you expect me to apologize, you are a bigger fool than I thought. Wickham stepped closer. And if you expect me to take your interference lying down, you are a bigger fool than I thought. Darcy smelled the whiskey on Wickham's breath as he stood before him, and he saw a glint in the man's eyes, like he was planning a murder. Darcy scoffed. I am not afraid of you, Wickham. You ought to be. I do not suppose you or your family would appreciate it were I to expose your family's greatest secret. You can have no doubt of what I am talking about. Darcy drew closer still. You would be better off spending your time avoiding debtor's prison. He glared at Wickham. It would appear you have racked up considerable debt in your wake, debt I was obliged to take on, what with your being an old friend of the family. Now that you are as good as an enemy, I deemed it even wiser to pursue this course. Now, leave my sight. Indeed, from this point on, turn and go the other way when you see me coming. And do not let me hear about your taking advantage of vulnerable young women, or I shall know how to act. Wickham brushed his hand over his face in disbelief that Darcy had prevailed over him again. He was angry. He was aggrieved. He was gone directly. Unfortunately, Wickham did not go very far. Indeed, the opportunity to spite his former friend was too tempting to resist. He had seen how Darcy behaved toward Miss Elizabeth Bennet, and how she looked at him. He especially recalled with disdain seeing the two of them on the dance floor at the last ball. It was one thing to realize his power over Elizabeth had faded after he had worked so meticulously to garner her favor. It was another thing to know Darcy was the cause. Once again, Darcy had taken away something from Wickham that might have meant something to him. True, Miss Elizabeth was not rich enough to expose Wickham to any real danger, but there were other aspects for a healthy man to contemplate. Now that Miss Mary King was beyond his reach, thanks to Darcy, Wickham supposed the least he should do was plant seeds of doubt in Elizabeth's pretty head. Then Darcy, too, might know how it felt to have his intentions thwarted. Intentions which, according to Wickham's way of thinking, were less than honorable. Wickham saw Elizabeth standing alone as he headed for the door, after telling Mr. Denny he was going to London. Throwing himself in her path, he begged to speak with her in privacy for a moment. The first thing Elizabeth did when he approached her was to make a mental note of where she was standing. Her silly sisters had scattered too much mistletoe about for her to risk being caught under it with anyone, especially the likes of George Wickham. She had no intention of allowing the man to accompany her to a secluded spot. Whatever he wished to say to her, it was best he said it right there where they stood. She told him as much. It is a shame your opinion of me has suffered such a sharp decline in the weeks since the return of a certain gentleman who shall remain unnamed. A shame indeed, for you and I were always so close. Elizabeth stayed silent, which encouraged him to continue. I would be remiss were I not to warn you to be wary of him. I have known him all my life. He may spend time with you. He may even fancy himself taken by you, what with your being here in Meryton, and far away from those he considers his equal. But trust me when I say he will not marry someone like you. His family would consider it an abhorrence, as he no doubt would himself. You may point to his tolerance for his friend Bingley's courtship with your sister, and teach yourself to hope it is a sign he would countenance such an unequal alliance for himself. However, Charles Bingley is no Fitzwilliam Darcy, what with his own fortune's origins and trade. So much for not mentioning a certain gentleman's name. It is not that I am afraid to mention his name. It is just that I find it particularly distasteful to do so. And if you really knew what he was about, you would feel the same. Men like him marry wealthy women whose fortune and status rival their own. In Darcy's case, his future wife is his cousin, Miss Anne de Bird. You do recall my telling you about their engagement, do you not? I recall you telling me many things, sir. You need not take my word for it. If you doubt it, ask the gentleman yourself. If he is indeed as honorable as he would have others believe him to be, he will be bound to tell you the truth. Elizabeth was momentarily at a loss for words, owing to the implications of Wickham's speech. Despite their difference in status, Mr. Darcy had been so kind to her. Surely Wickham was just feeling sorry for himself, because he would never marry someone as wealthy as Mr. Bird. That must be it.
And yet, she suffered a twinge of sadness at the thought that something as superficial as money might influence someone as wonderful as Mr. Darcy when choosing a spouse. But she did not intend to let Wickham know his words affected her.
I have no intention of doing so. Any conversation I may or may not have with Mr. Darcy will surely not result from anything you have to say. And here I thought you were too intelligent to allow sentiment to outweigh reason. Or perhaps you have taken my words to heart and are planning to do as I advise, at which point I am sure you will thank me. Having done my duty to you, all that is left for me is to bid you adieu. It seems this part of the country is not big enough for my former friend and me to coexist, and I no longer wish to be bothered by his presence. Elizabeth breathed a deep sigh of relief when the gentleman bowed and quit the house. Good riddance, she considered, further supposing if she never set eyes on him again, it would be too soon. As for his unsolicited advice, she had no choice but to dismiss it. She would not ask Mr. Darcy about Wickham's claim. She could not, for what if it were true? What if she did not know Mr. Darcy as well as she thought she did?
Chapter 10. Her aunt's advisement had given Elizabeth something to think about. Wickham's words about Mr. Darcy's marital preferences also took their toll on her equanimity. However, she was loath to admit it. She promised to be cautious and ensure that none of her feelings escaped her. It was not just the intimate friendship Mr. Darcy and she shared that she was so keen to conceal, but also the profound love and affection she had developed for him. Maintaining this resolve was easy on the first day, when she had the excuse to spend time with her London relations as her chief employment. Her vow remained intact on the second day, when the gentlemen were busy with their fox hunt.
But by the third day,
Elizabeth was desperate for Mr. Darcy's company, which vexed her exceedingly. She began to consider that maybe they were not in as much danger of each other as she thought. Mr. Darcy was the more experienced of the two. Surely he knew if their situation was ever going to become more than friendship. As much as she missed him, what if he did not miss her? Undoubtedly, he could have spent time with her had he truly wished it. Mr. Bingley found a way to see Jane, albeit secretly. Each night, he had prevailed upon her to meet him long after the Longbourn household had settled. Not that Jane had confessed to Elizabeth what she was about, but why else would she leave her apartment under the cover of darkness and return mere hours before the break of day? Jane did, however, confess that Mr. Bingley had offered his hand in marriage. This intelligence eased Elizabeth's mind considerably, given how the two lovers may or may not have been spending their time. Elizabeth, curious creature though she was, did not ask, and Jane, the inhibited person she was, did not say.
Jane's happiness was everything Elizabeth hoped it would be.
Still, it was a stark reminder of her sister's predicament just under a month prior. Everyone thought Bingley had left the area with no immediate plans to return, and they had felt sorry for her because of it. The thought that Mr. Darcy might easily take his leave with no plans to return struck a chord of panic in Elizabeth's heart. She had no right to be disappointed if he indeed left. He had made her no formal declaration, not even an informal declaration. What others may have detected as symptoms of love between them
may have been solely a consequence of Elizabeth's unexpressed desires and expectations.
Mr. Darcy had offered her friendship, and he had bestowed it most agreeably. Beyond that, he owes me nothing. Happy was the day Miss Charlotte Lucas made Mr. William Collins the luckiest man in the world. The young lady's family was undoubtedly happy having rid themselves of a daughter who was 27 and somewhat of a burden. Before Mr. Collins arrived in that part of the country,
They had no hopes for such an advantageous alliance. Sir William Lucas invited everyone who was anyone to the wedding breakfast at Lucas Lodge. Even Mrs. Bennet would have been impressed with the festivities. Having learned of her eldest daughter's engagement to Mr. Bingley, Mrs. Bennet could not help sighing with pity for the Lucases, and citing Charlotte's marriage would be nothing compared to Jane's to those in her immediate party who would listen. And when she was not doing that, she was quietly chiding Elizabeth, saying, "It should have been you. It could have been you. And why on earth was it not you walking down the aisle with Mr. Collins?" Elizabeth spent the better part of the occasion trying to pacify her mother into silence. That, and suffering the embarrassment of seeing her two younger sisters jostling with each other for a place beneath the mistletoe. Thank heaven the gentlemen in the crowd were too sensible to go anywhere near them. What a spectacle her family was making. And Mr. Darcy was standing with his friend Mr. Bingley and taking it all in. Little did Elizabeth know her mortification was yet to come. Anyone who knew Mrs. Bennet could not seriously expect her not to boast of her family's joyful news. But at least she had the presence of mind to wait until after the newlyweds had taken their leave. Not that Jane's news had not been circulated by now. On the heels of learning the information, Mrs. Bennet was privileged to whisper it to her sister, Mrs. Phillips, over tea, who then ventured, without permission, to repeat it to her neighbors. But this was Mrs. Bennet's first occasion to boast of her good fortune for everyone to hear. She used every womanly trick she knew as a mother of five unwed daughters, who relished in one-upping her neighbor, Lady Lucas, could be expected to use. "Mark your calendars," Mrs. Bennet concluded. "I invite you all to what is certain to be the grandest wedding breakfast all of Hertfordshire has ever witnessed." Mrs. Bennet, Jane, and Mr. Bingley were inundated with wishes of joy as Elizabeth watched them from across the room. Lydia, who was standing close to Elizabeth, shouted, "No doubt you will boast of another wedding in the not-too-distant future as well, Mama." Mrs. Bennet spun around on her heel. "What on earth are you thinking of, child?" she cried. "Though I dearly wish to welcome another such occasion, I am quite persuaded there shall be no such opportunity." "I don't know about that," Lydia replied. "Our Lizzie and her Mr. Darcy cannot be spending so much time in each other's company of late for nothing. Look, Mr. Darcy, Lizzie is standing underneath the mistletoe as we speak. What better time than now to seal your fate as husband and wife than with a kiss?" Elizabeth had been too busy being appalled by her mother's conduct to pay attention to where she stood. Indeed, she had been most conscientious about avoiding being caught underneath the peculiar plant. She supposed she was as crimson as the velvety ribbons strung through the sprigs of mistletoe hanging just overhead. Humiliated and flustered, she hesitated for a moment before turning on her heel and fleeing the room. Lydia's laughter rang in her ears as she ran, but Elizabeth could not bring herself to care. As far as she was concerned, nothing could be more humiliating than this deeply mortifying situation so recklessly forced upon her. "What must others be thinking of me? What must Mr. Darcy think? Surely he must be disgusted with my family and me, and want nothing more to do with me. Will he flee Hertfordshire as precipitously as I fled the room full of shocked spectators just now? Are derision and embarrassment now to be my constant companions?" The cold winter air hit Elizabeth's face as flashes of thought continued to consume her busy mind. What just happened back there? Why did Lydia have to go on like that? How dare she embarrass me so publicly? A voice calling out from behind soon interrupted her thoughts. Chapter 11. Jane hurried to Elizabeth's side with the latter's cloak, a deep red color, and embroidered with golden-colored thread. She wrapped it around her sister's shoulders. "I am sorry about Lydia's carelessness. I can hardly imagine what she must have been thinking." While putting on a half-smile, Elizabeth dabbed her eyes, trying to hide how she felt. "You know how Mama can be when it comes to besting Lady Lucas. Of course, Lydia was simply being Lydia. If anything, I ought to apologize for escaping the room the way I did, and no doubt causing you even more embarrassment than her mother and Lydia combined." Jane shook her head. "Do not fret over me. Nothing can rob me of the happiness I feel in being engaged to the man I love. Oh, Lizzie, if I could but see you just as happy.
Elizabeth interrupted her sister, thinking surely such happiness had completely eluded her in the wake of what just happened. I know I should not have run away like that, but I could not risk seeing the look on Mr. Darcy's face in the aftermath of Lydia's foolishness. Surely he must hate me and want nothing to do with me ever again. With a hand on each side of Elizabeth, Jane leaned in and let her arms envelop her sister in a warm hug. No, Miss Elizabeth, nothing could be further from the truth. Jane and Elizabeth's heads snapped in the direction of a gentleman's voice. It was Mr. Darcy. One of them reacted with pleasure and the other in disbelief. Elizabeth wondered how long he had been standing there. Miss Bennet, may I have a private audience with Miss Elizabeth? Jane curtsied and walked away at once. Mr. Darcy approached Elizabeth with a concerned face. How are you? The gaieties the season generally brings afforded many opportunities to be in each other's company of late. However, this was the closest Elizabeth had been to him in days, and their first time alone. How she had missed him, and wished she had not kept him at a distance, now when all such tender feelings must surely be in vain. I ought to ask you that question, should I not? I cannot believe my sister placed you in such an unenviable position. What must you think of her? What must you think of me? You are a captive in this untenable situation through no choice of your own. And if you told me you never wished to see me again, I surely would not blame you. I do not know that I have ever suffered such mortification in all my life. I am sorry you feel that way, Miss Elizabeth. Surely you are equally mortified, if not more so. No, Miss Elizabeth, I am not the least bit mortified. Had you not fled the room, I would have shown you how I felt. I do not understand, Mr. Darcy. What I am saying, Miss Elizabeth, is had you not run out of the room, well, I think my actions would have spoken for themselves. At a loss for words, Elizabeth stared at Mr. Darcy. His face was flushed, his eyes full of longing and desire. But he remained quiet as the moment's intensity hung between them in thick silence. Elizabeth hardly believed what she was hearing. Did this mean her feelings were reciprocated? Sensing her confusion over his declaration, Mr. Darcy stepped toward her. Their bodies were almost touching. He gazed deeply into her eyes as he slowly reached out to cup her cheek. No doubt your sister set off a firestorm of insinuations, allegations, and speculations, with talk of a second impending marriage. We should give everyone something to talk about by making the rumors come true. What are you saying? Marry me, Miss Elizabeth. Sir, we hardly know each other. One might say the same of your sister and my friend, yet you must indeed believe their alliance is meant to be. Elizabeth could scarcely believe it was happening. The moment she had dreamed of. She knew that even after all they had done together over the past weeks, there was still so much to learn about each other. She smiled to herself in recollection of her friend Charlotte's sage advice concerning Jane and Mr. Bingley's courtship. I should think she had as good a chance of happiness if she were to be studying his character for a 12-month. Happiness in marriage is entirely a matter of chance. I suppose you have a point, she said. I know I do. I have been waiting my whole life to find someone like you. And I know if I do not seize this moment, I will not only be waiting for the rest of my life, but I will be wasting the rest of my life. I do not want to keep waiting and wasting time. It's you, Elizabeth. It's you that I need and you that I want. I love you most ardently. I love you too, Mr. Darcy, Elizabeth said. Expressing her love for him out loud was like a breath of fresh air. Tiny flakes of snow began to fall, not too much to cause anyone any real inconvenience, but just enough to cast a wintry spell. Shall we take our place inside, underneath the mistletoe, to seal our fate with a kiss, as your sister prognosticated? The snowflakes on her face were like feather kisses, soft and delicate, cold but not uncomfortable. By now, Mr. Darcy was standing so close. close enough for Elizabeth to feel the heat from his body. She turned her head to look at his handsome face and saw him smiling at her, unguardedly, reminding her of how endearing he had become to her. It was such a simple gesture on his part, but one that made her feel cherished and adored, and most importantly, loved, as he said, most ardently. It meant everything to Elizabeth to know beyond any doubt that Mr. Darcy felt for her what she felt for him, feelings that extended the bounds of mere friendship, beyond anything she had ever hoped or dreamed of for herself before getting to know him. Not just feelings of physical attraction or mutual desire compelled him to look at her as he did at that moment. Can there be any better sign? No, she said, placing her hands on his lapels. If we are to seal our fates as future husband and wife with a kiss, it is far better to do so in privacy. What say you, Mr. Darcy? I love you, he whispered softly before leaning in closer and capturing Elizabeth's lips tenderly against his own in a loving kiss. As they kissed passionately, amid gentle caresses and soft whispers, declarations of their love for each other flowing freely from both of their lips, it suddenly occurred to Elizabeth how right everything felt now, better than anything she could have imagined for herself just a short while ago. Sir, perhaps I ought to take you up on your offer to return inside and assume our place underneath the mistletoe for everyone to see us seal our fate. That is, unless, of course, you have other thoughts on how we ought to progress. Now, what say you? My dearest, loveliest Elizabeth, he said, brushing a kiss along the edge of her lip. What do you think? Chapter 12. The silvery light from the moon danced with the frost on the ground as the Darcy carriage clambered down the street on that chilly January night. Inside the carriage, all was delightful. Mr. Darcy took Elizabeth's hand in his, leaned in closer to her, and openly admired her ring, a dazzling diamond set in gold. I have never seen you look lovelier, he said, bringing her hand to his lips. Pray, how did you enjoy your first Twelfth Night as Mrs. Darcy? What a whirlwind of excitements and firsts it had been since Elizabeth had garnered her new appellation, Mrs. Darcy. First, there had been her hastened marriage by special license. Unlike Jane and Mr. Bingley, Mr. Darcy and Elizabeth had no wish to delay the beginning of their new lives together. Elizabeth being the first of the Bennet daughters to marry was a blessing in and of itself. Mrs. Bennet was not about to object to the scheme. How could she, when getting rid of her second eldest daughter was something she never thought she would do? Nor could Elizabeth's father object for that matter. Far better his favorite daughter should marry a man like Mr. Darcy than any of the other young men who had crossed her path. Mrs. Gardiner approved of the match. She considered her niece knew what she was about all along. There was also the joy of meeting her new sister, Miss Georgiana Darcy, along with Mr. Darcy's aristocratic relations, the Fitzwilliams. Elizabeth had been spared the opportunity of meeting Lady Catherine de Bourgh, but given all Mr. Collins had to say about the grand lady, Elizabeth could have no cause to repine. Meeting Lady Catherine was one of those firsts that would have to wait. No doubt, the formidable introduction would take place in due time. Next was an expeditious trip to Derbyshire, allowing Elizabeth to glimpse Pemberley, her new home. Her heart pounded in a chorus of excitement upon alighting from the carriage and being welcomed by an army of servants. She was in awe of the grandeur of the home and the lanes. However, they had scarcely been there a night and a day before they set off for London, where they were to remain for the better part of the season, just in time to attend the annual Twelfth Night Ball by Mr. Darcy's aunt and uncle, Lord and Lady Fitzwilliam. With good roads and good weather conspiring in their favor, and a constant supply of fresh horses galloping at a breakneck pace throughout the trip, the newlyweds had spent more time on the highway than they had in the privacy of one or the other of their homes. What better way to get to know each other than inside the closed confines of a luxury carriage replete with all the requisite privacy lovers could desire. Moreover, the inns they stayed in during their travels were comfortable enough for the newlyweds' purposes. So long as they were together, there was no place else either wished to be. I enjoyed every minute of the ball while we were there, Elizabeth replied. Surely you do not fault me for wanting to spend the best part of our first twelfth night as man and wife with you all to myself. I have special plans for the two of us, the likes of which can only be carried out in our own home. Do tell. Dare I hope for a repetition, or should I say, the resumption of our earlier endeavors? Teasing Mr. Darcy was one thing, but tempting him, especially now, when she knew it was within her power to do so, was another thing altogether. I shall never tire of the joy of teasing him, but that is nothing compared to the pleasures I derive from tempting him. Indeed, tempting him is far better. To taste his soft lips, and oh, so much more. I could tell you of my plans, my love, but I would much rather show you, Mr. Darcy said, his voice low, melodic, and filled with purpose. He reached out his fingers, caressing Elizabeth's cheek. How about a mixture of show and tell? It was enough said. The Twelfth Night ball may have been over, but their personal Twelfth Night celebration had just begun. And oh, what a night it will be.
You have been listening to Abounds with Gaieties, written and read by P.O. Dixon. If you enjoyed this story, subscribe and listen to full-length audiobooks for free. And don't forget to like this video before you go.